Thank you guys for being here. My name is Ron Schneidermann. I'm here today to talk to you guys about A/B testing. And we're gonna cover a lot of ground. I'm sure a lot of you guys have had some kind of experience in the past with A/B testing. But I think we're gonna go really deep into some topics here. Hopefully you find it interesting. Hopefully you realize there's quite a bit that you might not know yet. To give you a little background about myself, I am currently the chief marketing officer over at AllTrails. If you're into spending time outdoors, definitely check it out. Actually, our founder of AllTrails came through 500 startups back in 2010. Prior to that, I was head of growth over at Yelp Reservations. Before that, for almost a decade, I was co-founder and chief marketing officer of a company called Liftopia. If you're into skiing or snowboarding, definitely check that out. And before that, I ran business development over at Hotwire, which is an old online travel site that your parents probably used. So I've been doing A/B testing all throughout my career, back when we were home rolling it over at Hotwire. And you know, my goal here is to teach you a little bit about what I've learned and at the end answer some questions. So let's just start with the easy stuff, right? Let's get this out of the way. What's A/B testing? Well, it's a method of comparing two versions of an app or a website against each other to determine which one performs better. It's pretty straightforward. It's nothing too crazy or advanced with this one. The reason why you should be paying attention, the reason why every single person in 500 Startups should be here paying attention to this presentation today is that whatever it is that you want to improve, with the right framework and methodology in place, you can laser focus in on that metric or set of metrics and move the needle. So there's that, right? It's incredibly powerful. It's a hugely important tool to have in your arsenal and to do it right if you're gonna do it. But the real secret, the thing that you won't find in any of the blog posts, the thing that I've learned in my experience why testing is awesome, is that it takes all of the ego out of decision making. So instead of the biggest title or a territorial PM or designer getting to call the shots just because they can, instead you have your data and your end users tell you what the right move is. Because the truth is, you guys don't know shit, and I don't know shit, right? This is the truth, but your users know what's up. And I feel like, especially for founders, again, I've been on this side of the room before. You know, sometimes we think we're smarter than our users, right? Sometimes we think we know what they want, but it just doesn't work like that. And if you think it works like that, you're going to be out of business quite soon. You know, this is what's great about testing is that, like, regardless of what Donald Trump thinks, data is apolitical, right? Like, we all have our hypotheses, we all have our hunches, we all have our shared experiences that we bring to the table, but testing and the data around testing levels the playing field. It brings different departments and stakeholders and managers together around a common set of metrics and goals, again, that is apolitical. So we got the easy stuff out of the way. Cool, hopefully there's nothing too crazy in there. And now you're fired up, you guys are excited, you wanna transform your organization into a data-driven testing machine. So these are the three questions that you and your executive teams need to ask yourselves before you get started. So just real quick, you'll see a little link at the bottom. Just a quick shout out to Brian Balfour, who wrote this awesome blog post on his Co-Elevate blog about finding your customer acquisition channel. A lot of these questions came from that, which are totally applicable to testing as well. So question number one, are we at the right phase in our life cycle for testing? You guys know, your resources are limited. A lot of these tests involve integrating resources across departments, across marketing, across product, across engineering, design. So as a leader, you need to determine whether their time could best be spent elsewhere. Question number two, what are we optimizing for? Why do we want to do testing? So different phases of your life cycle are gonna call for optimizing different things, right? So learning is typically the priority when your company is in the traction phase, sort of early on, which I'm assuming a lot of people in this room are in that phase. It's before you're transitioning into hyper growth, and some things that might fall under this are optimizing for product channel fit. You guys have all heard about product market fit, but every single company basically has one core channel that's going to fuel their growth. This is a great time to be testing for that. Audience segmentation, engagement, monetization, conversion rate, messaging. These are all things that fall under learning. Volume is when you have a good sense of your product market fit and your product channel fit, and you want to move the needle in a material way. So that's really just how far can I crank the dial on a given channel? And then profitability, so once you have your meaningful volume coming through your platform, be a specific or a couple of channels, you're going to want to focus on profitability. And so that's, can you drive down CPAs? Can you reduce churn? Can you increase your average order value? In addition to what specifically you're optimizing for, you also need to consider your constraints. And these are going to differ depending on your stage, your funding, things like that. There's typically about four constraints. So first one is time. Do you have a specific window to reach your audience? So In my career, I've worked at two very seasonal businesses. The one I'm currently at right now, AllTrails, is all about helping people spend more time outdoors, and the vast majority of our usage and our user acquisition and our monetization happens between April and October. That's our time constraint. That's when we need to do the majority of our needle moving. On the flip side, when I was at Liftopia, it was a hyper seasonal business. It was all about skiing and snowboarding. And we made about 90% of our revenues between November and March. So it's a very, very tight window. And that was definitely one of our biggest constraints. Another one is money. Again, something I'm sure you guys are all dealing with or are going to be dealing with. Are you bootstrapping or are you well-funded? And what that translates downstream into is can you throw enough money at a specific channel to truly determine whether there is product channel fit and an opportunity for traction within that channel, right? So there's no point playing around with a channel if you can't afford to organically sustain it moving forward once you do identify as being a good fit. It's target audience. How specific of an audience do you need to reach? When I was at Yelp doing Yelp reservations, it was a SaaS product, and we were selling it to restaurant owners and general managers. So even having the entire Yelp data set at my disposal, which is massive, it's non-trivial, it was still a very, very small subset of those users that I actually needed to target and reach. At Liftopia, only 3% of the US population skis. 3%, right? So if we pick the wrong channel, we're wasting 97% of our spend. And within that 3%, there's no real common psychographic or demographic profile, because these people live everywhere, they're all different ages, all different ability levels. That was by far our biggest constraint, by far, even more so than the seasonality and the time constraint, which is how do we reach this target audience of 3% of the population? Last one is legal. And this one is a little bit more modern than when I went through this, is, are you gonna be bumping up against legal and regulatory issues, right? So it's cool, it's great if you're in a space that you're gonna be asking for forgiveness and not permission, and obviously, handful of companies have done quite well for themselves taking that approach, Uber, Airbnb, et cetera, et cetera. But it will impact the complexion of your channels and the tests that you can run. Cool, so you've done your soul searching, you've asked yourselves the hard questions, you're ready to jump in and start testing. So here's a few ways to find good test hypotheses. First one is analytics. Just always start with your analytics. Always start with your analytics. Find, set up your flows, set up your funnels, find the underperforming flows and products in your funnel, and then figure out how you can plug those leaky holes and unlock the opportunities for growth. So this one's a personal favorite of mine, user testing, and it's about finding that disconnect between what you think your users do and what your users actually do. You can uncover this a few different ways. You can do user testing online, you can do it in person, you can use session recording tools, and just different ways of seeing how your users are reacting with your website or app. If you haven't done it, I will say it's always brutal, especially the first few times. And you'll probably want to watch these videos with a couple drinks or something just to dull the pain, because it's shocking and it's uncomfortable to see how unexpectedly people are trying to interact with your product that you so lovingly crafted and spent all this time building, let alone if they find a bug that you didn't even know about. And you see it in these videos, it's brutal. But, you know, from this pain comes growth and a lot of good test hypotheses. Heat map tracking and click mapping software are both great ways to reveal the disconnect between what you think the important elements on a page or within a screen are versus your users. We've been doing a lot of this at AllTrails lately, and it's uncovered so many hypotheses for us. Another great way is qualitative feedback, right? So this is gonna be stuff like reading your app reviews, reading the, if you do net promoter scores and have an open-ended question at the end, read that. Audit your customer support calls and emails and live chats. Do user surveys. Any other qualitative feedback you can get your hands on. When I started at AllTrails about 18 months ago, I spent the first 3 months just zeroing in on this. AllTrails had been around since 2010, right? So I spent weeks, reading through every single app review that we'd ever gotten and charting it out, how the sentiment changed over time. Because, you know, we have millions of downloads, right? So that's a lot of app reviews. I did all of the frontline customer support myself because I wanted to get a gauge on what features are causing the most problems, where is the disconnect with messaging, where are we letting our users down, just what are they getting the most pissed about, what are they happy about? I can't stress enough how important it is sometimes to get beyond the qualitative data and really dig in, or sorry, the quantitative data and really dig into the qualitative inputs as well. And then last one, research your competitors and just try and get a sense of what's working for them that you can leverage. And again, there's no real magic here, right? But this is like poke around on their website, download their apps, look at their app store listings, create an account on their site, buy something, watch their onboarding flows, try and get into their lifecycle marketing. Just see what they're doing for engagement and for promotions and things like that. And not everything that they do is gonna be right for you, nor should you be trying to blatantly copy them. But it's a great way to get a handle on what your strengths and weaknesses and opportunities are relative to your competitors. And if you don't have a specific competitor, find a company that you really respect and want to emulate and just see how they're doing all of this stuff. So, you've done your research, you're ready to roll up your sleeves and start testing. This to me is the fun part. I've been doing marketing for, again, well over a decade, probably 15 years now. This is the fun part. Like, it's that blend between the art and the science of it all. And for me, it's where the creative juices really get going. There's a lot. I threw a lot in here because I know we got a lot of different sectors, B2B, B2C, large audiences versus really small audiences. But there's a lot in here. Hopefully, you can find some stuff that works for you. So let's start with landing pages. Hopefully, this goes without saying, but if you're doing any sort of direct response marketing, you really, really need to be driving your users to landing pages and not your homepage. So maybe bullet number one should be use landing pages. Assuming you're using landing pages though, messaging is always a good, easy first thing to test. It's a great way to actually like test the testing platform. Quick wins usually with messaging. Can't recommend enough, start with that. Form fields. So form fields are something that sounds so boring, right? It's your form. But, you know, this is where the conversion happens, right? This is probably like, this is one of the single most important elements on your landing page or on your site. So do an audit, like really take a look. What exactly are you asking your users to fill out? How many fields are you putting in front of them? And then how many of those fields are truly, truly required to get that user across the finish line? right? Sometimes it's tempting to throw up additional fields so we can collect more data points, but as we do that, we introduce friction, which is gonna decrease conversion rate, right? So it's really, really important that you try and calibrate that. Do you have help text? Do you have clear label fields? Is there anything that's ambiguous or confusing? Is your error messaging too intrusive? Is it friendly or not, right? Test your form fields, so important. Layout, so especially with landing pages, this one's always intrigued me, I think it's a fun test. Is there a sweet spot? Is it better to have just like a short and sweet, all above the fold landing page, just really basic, don't get them to overthink anything, just try and get them through sign up or you know whatever the CTA is? Or is it better to have that super long scroll that has all of the information, you put it right in front of them, front and center? I don't know. I don't know the answer, test it, right? Another one is just like, is there such thing as an optimal number of columns? Is it better to have a big fat one column, two columns, three columns? I don't know. This one is another fun one too, like is sometimes less more or sometimes more? I don't know. It's interesting, right? Test it. This one's pretty standard, right? How many CTAs are you putting in front of your users? Especially with landing pages, like the answer should be one. But if you have more than one, cool, like test which ones make the most sense, test which ones are maximizing your conversion rate. Same with the CTA copy, just what exactly are you asking them to click on? Very easy to test to run. Social proof, you know, so this is like the testimonials, the endorsements, the as seen in block, as seen in TechCrunch. You know, sometimes this is cool, sometimes this is powerful, sometimes this is a great signal to show your users that like, yeah, we've been around, we're not going anywhere, we're legit. Sometimes it makes you look JV, right? Like how many, like does Amazon have as seen in TechCrunch? Fuck no, right? Test this stuff. Sometimes that you think it might help, it might actually be hurting, or vice versa. Sometimes it's great. Sometimes it's what your users need to see to get them comfortable, get them across the finish line. Test it. Video. Is video a good thing? I don't know. Test it. And then this one's always interesting too. Sometimes it's controversial. But do you want to provide access to site-wide navigation? Or you just want to lock it down, have it just be like a tunnel, and the only way for the user to get through this tunnel is to click on your CTA or bounce. But it's worth testing. Test it. Homepage too. So I'm guessing your homepage sees a lot of traffic. Again, hopefully not because you're funneling direct response campaigns to your homepage. But you know, homepages usually fall into the realm of low-hanging fruit. And you'll see there's a lot of similarities with the landing pages. Messaging, great place to start. Imagery, the layout, primary navigation. So do you want to have a big, if you're selling products or a suite of products, do you want to have a big open-ended search box? Or do you want to kind of guide them via browse experience to a specific product? Number of CTAs and the CTA copy. And again, the social proof video as well, right? Very similar to your landing pages, but what works on one isn't necessarily going to work on the other. It's a totally different use case, right? So just think through through your end user. Test this stuff separately. So checkout flow. So these tests are usually a little bit harder to implement programmatically because you're kind of getting into the guts of your product here. But they can dramatically improve your conversion rates and are definitely worth spending time on if you can. So some checkout flow ideas to test. Again, with the form fields, I can't overemphasize enough. Test your form fields. This one's always interested me. Is there a sweet spot? Is it better to have fewer and longer pages to check out, like just one long checkout page broken out into sections? Or is it better to have many short and sweet ones that kind of don't overwhelm the user with too much cognitive load? I don't know the answer. I've had success personally with both, but you know, every product that you're selling is different. Test it. Again, access to site-wide navigation versus lockdown navigation. If you read on like design blogs and usability blogs, again, it's pretty controversial. People feel really strongly about both, but it's worth testing. Does it help move the needle to provide breadcrumbs to your users so they know how far along the booking path they are? Cross-selling of other products. So this one's interesting too. So when I was at Hotwire, which was like 13 years ago, I was in charge of their ancillary revenue streams. And what that means is just like, how do we squeeze more money out of every customer that came through the site? So some basic ones, some things that you guys have probably seen that falls under that, are things like trip insurance, right? Like every OTA has a trip insurance module on their site. That was one of the things, the portfolio. One of the ones that we were so excited to launch, there was so much hope around this, was trip add-ons. So let's say you're going to Hawaii, you booked your flight, you booked your hotel, and we're like, yo, here's a swim with dolphins package. Hey, check out this ATV tour, right? And we were trying to upsell them when they're excited. They, you know, the hypothesis was like peak excitement. You know, you just got your tickets, you know, you're ready, you have your wallet out, you want to spend some money. Cool, buy this stuff. But the take rates were super low. And not only that, like we were seeing some funky data coming through that really made us question whether this was the right approach. So we set up a test. 50% of our traffic had trip add-ons in the flow. 50% did not. And after running this for a while, what we found was that our net revenue actually went up when we did not have these trip add-ons in the booking path because the conversion rate was so much higher. So that uptick in conversion rate way more than offset the decreased average order value and the incremental revenue that we were getting from trip add-ons. And we ended up actually taking that and rolling it out across the Expedia portfolio because it was such a needle-moving test for us. That said, at Liftopia, we had a ton of success cross-selling other products like lessons and rentals and things like that. So it again, test it. Phone number, live chat, whether to do any sort of assisted bookings if you have an e-commerce site. At Liftopia, we tested this. And what we found, we added a phone number to the booking path. So nowhere on the site, on no landing pages, not on our homepage. You know, we really wanted to contain the scope of this, the volume of calls coming through. So once you got into the booking path though, we put a phone number up. And what we found was that not only did our conversion rate go up, but our average order value went up like something like 25, 30% as well, right? And so this way more than offset the additional internal cost to staffing and training these seasonal employees. This was like a grand slam for us. This was like a major, major milestone, a realization for us at Liftopia, and we wouldn't have realized it without testing. Post-conversion marketing. So what can you do to squeeze more dollars out of your existing customers, right? And if it's not dollars, then a product review or an app store review, something like that, right? Something when their sentiment is high. Tons of opportunities with post-conversion marketing. So pricing is really hard to test. I don't know how many of you guys have tried to do pricing tests. This is one of the hardest things for a startup to do, is just nail your pricing. And again, like it's really, really hard to test it because people get pissed if they find out that they can get the exact same product on the exact same site for a cheaper rate. Orbitz, an old, now defunct online travel site, got into a ton of trouble a few years ago because what they were doing is they were sniffing computers, and if they saw that you were on a Mac, they would actually raise your prices, right? So, you know, be mindful of that, but there are a few things that you can do to try and test like pricing to move the needle. So the first one is a free trial. Does it make sense if you have a SaaS product, does it make sense to offer a free trial? I will say, when I was at Yelp selling Yelp reservations, we blew this. We totally blew this. When I started, it was all about self-serve and free trial, and we would give away the product for a week, and then at the end of that week, our sales reps would call you up, and they'd be all fired up, and like, yeah, this is a slam dunk, and like, no one was buying anything. And in digging into it further, and then, you know, so we run some tests, we dig into it further, and what we find is that it was such an onerous setup process during the free trial setup flow that people were skipping steps. And then when you skip steps, they weren't coming back to really like spend the time investing in the proper setup and configuration. And so after the week, they're frustrated. They never used it because it wasn't set up properly. And what happened was they were drawing false conclusions about the quality of our product because they didn't do the fucking free trial, right? What can you do about that, right? So what we did instead was we abandoned the free trial. We cut it off, and instead we forced users to get on the phone with our sales reps. And while, you know, it limited our throughput, what we found was that our conversion rate was so much higher that, again, it more than offset it. It was a no-brainer for us. Money-back guarantee, that's a great thing to test. It can also be really expensive, but it's worth testing this in the early phases, in that learning phase, then later on. And annuals, if you do have a subscription business, an annual subscription versus monthly, this is something that we're kicking the tires on at AllTrails right now, and we'll probably test it at some point in 2017. And so, you know, the question for us is, are we ultimately going to make more money by selling a higher priced annual subscription that has a higher LTV and a low conversion rate versus a lower price, like more bite-sized monthly subscription that's going to have a way higher conversion rate? Like, we know that, but the churn is going to be super high and the LTV is going to be way lower. Which one is going to ultimately make us more money? And I don't know the answer, and this is an incredibly scary test for us internally, but I think we need to find the answer to that. So that's another thing for you guys to consider testing as well. Last section here, email ideas. You guys have probably noticed I'm trying to stay away from like marketing channel specific tests because, again, I don't know how many of you guys know your product channel fit, or if you've settled in on a specific channel, and, you know, depending if you're on B2B, B2C, whatever, you know, not every channel works for everyone, but pretty much everyone does email. And it's super easy to spin up tests with email, and most email service providers and the platforms have these tests built in. So obviously, subject line, right? Is there an optimal length? What are the keywords that are gonna increase open rate? Do emojis move the needle on open rate? Content, again, you see, you kind of notice this theme here, but like, is it better to do short versus long? I'm intrigued by this concept of plain text emails and like just getting short and sweet directly to the point and seeing if that moves the needle. Number of CTAs and what the CTAs say. The from name, there's some tests to run there. Personally, I don't think it's a huge needle mover, but something we're checking out. The send time, I don't know. I've never seen it move the needle, but it is something that one could theoretically test. Cart abandonment. So again, if you have like e-commerce, B2C, something like that, this is one of those things that feels like it falls under low-hanging fruit and is kind of a no-brainer, but it can very easily have unintended consequences. And you know, so what you're gonna wanna do is you wanna test this. You wanna test, like, do you wanna send it minutes or hours or days after the abandonment? Whether you include an offer, if you do, how much? Because the unintended consequence, what you want to avoid at all costs, is conditioning your users to abandon their carts, right? And it happens all the time. Like, my wife shops online a lot at like Gap and JCrew and all those guys. And for a while, they were like, you would just leave the cart and they'd send you a coupon. And all it was doing was training their highest value customers and pushing them into their lowest yield channels. It doesn't make sense. It didn't make sense. So if you are going to do cart abandonment, just test it. On the flip side, you have this post-purchase offer. So again, how do you get that next transaction within as short of a time frame as possible? We had a ton of luck at Liftopia with expiring gift credits, right? So you come on, you buy, a three-day pass to Squaw, and, you know, within minutes, we would send you a gift credit, and we would test the amount, $5, $10, $20, depending on the average order size, things like that. And these gift credits would expire within 24, 48, 72 hours. Again, it was another like major win for us unlocking this channel. And then, you know, if it's not the next order, it can also be unlocking an app review or product view, a social share, things like that. But just how do you get another win, another quick win out of your existing customers when they're happy after they just bought something? Cool. So that was a lot, right? So now moving on, like, how do you actually do this? Like, you want to roll up your sleeves, you're excited, you're ready. How do you do it? I'm not here to tell you that. The truth is, like, I don't have a horse in this race. I'm not, you know, getting endorsements from anyone. There's a ton of platforms out there. But the reason why I'm not going to do it is because it's just not one size fits all. And so you need to find the right one for you based off of your platform, based off of the cost, the features, whatever it is, right? The good news is that, one, there's a ton of data out there. Here are some very specific blog posts I think you guys should check out. They do a great job of breaking down the different platforms and costs and prices against each other and features against each other as well. But also, most of the platforms are super easy to spin up. It's usually just like a JavaScript snippet or something like that. And the opportunity cost isn't so high to switch if you try one out and then realize, like, this one's missing that. I'd rather have that. So it's easy to port from one to another. The main takeaway is just go with one. Just set one up. Just set it up. Just start. Just start somewhere. Do your research. Start. Pick one. Iterate if you have to. Once you do have your infrastructure set up, main thing to remember is that testing is a cycle, right? So you're always going to start with your hypotheses. So you want to generate a hypothesis, like what change or changes do you think are going to impact which metric, right? Have a laundry list. We have whiteboards just full of these things. The tricky part is prioritizing, and that takes a lot of discipline. And that's really like if you could actually impact a metric, if you could move the needle on a specific metric, what would have the biggest impact to your company goals? And this is just like spreadsheeting and just like really just digging into the numbers, see where in the funnel it makes most sense and what's going to have the biggest output from that. And I would strongly suggest taking into consideration the stuff from part two earlier in the presentations. We were talking about the pre-testing questions and constraints, because that's gonna directly impact how you prioritize these tests. Next up, you're gonna create variations, right? So this is where the rubber meets the road. And it's really how easy or hard is it to set up these tests and create these additional variations? Because what you don't wanna do is draw false conclusions about the quality of a hypothesis or the quality of a test because you did a shitty implementation. The level of complexity involved in creating these tests is also gonna impact how you prioritize, because again, like, it's a zero-sum game, right? You need dev resources to set up this test, or you need them to ship product. You, as the leader, need to decide where that time is best allocated. Spend some time on that. And then, you run the experiment, you analyze the results, you iterate, you repeat, or you move on to the next test. The final piece of advice I can give you is that there's stuff you're going to inevitably fuck up. We all do it. I have fucked up so many tests. I fucked up one last week. Like, it happens all the time. But again, from these mistakes come growth, right? And it's all good so long as you just don't keep making the same mistakes twice. So when you're running your experiments and you're analyzing your results, just watch out for these gotchas. First one is just don't test too many variations concurrently. The more variations that you test against each other, the more traffic you need, the longer you have to run your tests to get results that you can trust, statistical significance, things like that, the more expensive it becomes. In my opinion, in my experience, it's better to do just simple A-B testing. You'll get your results faster. You'll learn faster. You can improve and iterate on your tests or your hypotheses or move on to the next one. You'll also avoid false positives. Since the more variations you introduce, the higher the risk of a false positive. And you start getting into some more advanced stats when you're dealing with false positive and things like that, but it's probably worth spending, if you're gonna be the ones running these tests or managing this program, it's worth spending some time digging into stats, refreshing your stats background, and trying to level up on this stuff. Don't end your test too early. This is a huge frustration of mine. Most of the big platforms that you use and also the ESPs have statistical significance calculators built in, and most of them are shit. Just, they don't work. They always call the test too soon, so watch out for these A-B testing tools calling it early, and then always try and double check the numbers in some sort of third-party statistical significance calculator if you can. The worst thing that you can do is have confidence in data that's inaccurate or not statistically significant, because again, the whole point of testing is like these need to be repeatable, right? And so anyways, I could go on about that one. Just don't end your test too early and take the statistical significance calculators on these platforms with a huge grain of salt. Don't ignore the external factors. So you want to test in as controlled and sterile of an environment as possible. If you have tests that run during big shopping seasons, like Black Friday, Cyber Monday, or Christmas, you're going to want to rerun them once that period is over. Other factors might be like whether your company is doing like a big TV campaign or like, you know, any other like big widespread campaign with a huge reach. Or, you know, have you guys been in the news recently for the right or the wrong reasons? These are things that are going to impact your tests. And it can skew your results, right? That's really the big challenge with that is you don't want skewed results. You need to be aware of the macro things surrounding your company. Last one, most tests fail, right? Just because a test didn't move the needle, it doesn't mean that the root hypothesis was off. It could have been due to external factors. It could have been a shitty implementation, something in between. If you've zeroed in on something that you think needs to be improved, just run a follow-up test, maybe simplify it, try and do two very diametrically opposed implementations to see which one is the right path to then start iterating on. You know, run your follow-up test, repeat, iterate, improve your hypotheses, et cetera. So last thing is I added an appendix here, and you guys can all get this deck. Some homework for you, some additional reading that you may or may not find helpful, but I certainly have found helpful over the last few years. And that's it. So. All right, so yeah, let's open it up for some questions here, and then I gotta make sure I'm doing this right with the, all right. Okay, so the question was, any advice for A/B testing chatbots? I have never, in my experience, used chatbots before, but I would guess that there's probably, I don't even know, actually, I shouldn't even speak to this because I've never been hands-on, but I'm gonna guess timing, frequency before, like how long until you funnel them over to a real-life person, what are the trees look like, what are the like trigger keywords that are gonna get them on with a real person, things like that. That's a great question. So the question is, like, you want to watch out for, you know, pulling the test too early, not having statistical significance, but you also need to watch out for, like, running something too long and the novelty wearing off and regressing to the mean. So it's a real trap because in my experience, if you aggregate, like, if I were to go and aggregate all of the, like, step-up improvements on conversion rate that I had amassed, you know, at any given company, like our conversion rates, theoretically, it should be like 50%, but like it's never like that, right? It's always gonna be like somewhere within the range. So yeah, I do think that there is something to be said about novelty. I don't know how to account for it other than to always be testing, always, always. If you do feel as if there is a regression going on, like how can you shock the system and introduce something again that's like either, when you're testing, you can either do two things, right? You can either tweak your way to like small incremental improvements, 1%, 2%, 5% at a time, or you try and get like the big step up improvements. And so it's like a personal decision, a personal strategic choice as to how you want to attack your testing. But like that would be an example of like, well, fuck, like what if we do what we did before, or what if we just go crazy, do something else? Like, does that move it up or down compared to this? So that's why it's just like, you always need to be in your data. You always need to be testing and just not settling once you see that there's like, your conversion rate optimization is never done, right? Yeah, and that's where the constraints around segmentation make a lot of sense, right? Like, is the same landing page experience going to work for your registered users versus new unregistered users, email, all of these things, right? So it's just like the more defined you can make your test groups, the more clarity you're going to get around those kind of diminishing returns, I'd say. Oh yeah. Well, I think the main thing is breaking it down. Oh, so the question is like, do I have experience A/B testing funnels? How do you go about that? And I think the main thing again is you can't attack it like a big monolithic project, right? So like the worst case scenario, so you have your conversion funnel and then you have this totally new one that's just one page, different color, right? Too many variables. So if you, let's say the new one works, you don't know why it worked. You don't know where exactly, the improvement came from and what the negative impacts might have been, because all you're getting is like the cumulative net impact as opposed to like each of the individual incremental improvements, right? So that's why I'm a big fan of just like very specific, very controlled tests so that you know exactly how you're manipulating each phase of the funnel. Does that make sense? Does that answer that for you? Yeah. Okay, so to clarify, you know, B2B, it's a little bit different. I mean, at Yelp Res, we totally changed our funnel, right? Like when leads got passed to which reps and how and all, like we totally changed it. But the root hypothesis was that, and maybe that's the answer. It's like every test needs to be based on one root hypothesis, right? And then you figure out like what are the pieces that are going to move the needle on that hypothesis? And is this a well-constructed test that's not going to have externalities that you can't account for? So for us, the root hypothesis was that self-serve is actually doing more harm than good. So let's cut it and just funnel people on the phone, right? There was a lot of shit we lost in the transition in between. That's one of the tricky things with B2B. And I know a lot of you guys are in the B2B space. A lot of you guys maybe don't have a ton of traffic. If you're in like government tech or ed tech, things like that. Like you're not gonna get a huge funnel of people coming through. And that's one of the tricky things with testing too, right? Like it's easy for me at AllTrails. Like we had like 20 million something uniques just come to our website last year, you know, millions of that. Like we have traffic coming. I've never in my career had this much traffic coming through where like the top of the funnel isn't the issue, it's all the downstream stuff. But with that said, like there's still ways to effectively test without massive quantities of traffic as well. You're not gonna have sort of the same approach necessarily, but the question is, can you find directional indicators whether or not you're on the right track? And what I mean by that is you can manufacture audiences, right? Like whether you go to usertesting.com, you stand out on the street and just bring people in, you do paper prototype testing, like whatever it is, you know, if it's a question about usability, if it's a question about messaging, things like that, like you don't need massive quantities. If something's broken, you're going to find it. And, you know, truthfully, you don't need to test your way to a fix. You can just implement a fix. But there are ways to kind of juice your audience just so at least you get some throughput going and you can throw some bodies against a test hypothesis. I am personally using Hotjar right now. It's pretty rad. Again, I don't work for them. They're not paying me anything, but it's pretty rad. I like it because like they don't crush you on overages. And they have like a full suite of products. So they do like the heat maps, like the click tracking and then the mouse tracking, tell you like what percent of users are getting how far down your pages. You can pop survey, quick polls, quick surveys to those users. They do recording. It's pretty sweet. It's not too expensive. And it's free for the first five pages, apparently. So, yeah. So in conclusion, there's a lot of love in this room for Hotjar. All right, next question. Yeah. So the question is, how do you approach the creative side to testing? I don't know if you saw the beginning. This is what I love about testing, though, is that it depoliticizes it, right? Like, I've been in so many situations where, you know, there's friction between design and marketing, or there's friction between design and product, or there's friction between marketing and product, you know, whatever. Like, there's going to be friction. People have really strong opinions about the integrity of the look and feel, you know, whatever it is. What's great about testing, again, is like it depoliticizes it. You put it up in front of your users. A lot of you might have heard about when Google tested 41 shades of blue back in 2000. It was the stupidest fucking test ever, right? Don't do that. Like even they in hindsight are like, that was stupid. Like it didn't work. It didn't do anything. But if you're talking about testing creative, like, you know, so for an ad campaign, let's say you're running Facebook ads, you know, is it better to have a face or no face in the ad? Is it better to be, you know, like a graphic image or a photo? Like, these are things you can test. You know, it only matters once you kind of have product channel fit. I guess with like your landing pages, you can test stuff. But again, you can drive yourself crazy. So the main thing is just like conceptually, what makes the most sense? Try and do it like big and whittle your way down. Once you decide that like photography works better than graphic imagery, you know, then what's the complexion of the photography? Is it better to have like blue skies and sunshine? Is it better to be indoors? Is it better to have a male face, a female face, a group of people, things like that? Like, try and do. Yeah, ultimately, I guess it depends on what it is that you're selling, but ultimately, your product and the quality of your product is going to be what moves the needle the most, right? So, like, I don't know. This is like the Airbnb fallacy. Like, everyone looks at Airbnb as this great shining example of what to do, but truthfully, like, the reason why they're so incredible is because they have this incredibly unique inventory that no one else has access to, and they make it really easy to book, right? It's not because they rebranded their logo, and it's not that crazy app redesign that they just did that will not work for any of us in this room if we try to pull it off, right? It's because they have like unique inventory that you can't find anywhere else. That's why it works. So this is one of those things, like, it's really easy to overthink it, but it ultimately doesn't matter so much. And I, like, designers hate hearing that, but it's the truth. Like, it's not the design that's going to move the needle and make your company get like massive traction. It's the quality of the product, the quality of the inventory that you sell, and whether you make it easy for people to buy it or not. If there's like a bro deal circling around 500 startups. So the question is there a platform, an A/B testing platform that you would recommend, especially for startups? And I would just say, like, if there's a deal floating around 500 startups, just do that. The main thing is just start, right? If you've heard a lot about Optimizely and want to try Optimizely, cool, start it, right? If you've used it and it's like, this doesn't work for me, I need something that does this, cool, use it. Again, the main thing is that, like, these are really cheap and easy to set up. It doesn't take a lot of dev work to set them up. So the main thing is just pick one, just start, and then see what you're bumping up against. And then with V2, you're gonna have a better set of what questions to ask for the next provider. So there is a deal through 500 for Optimizely. Great place to start. Question through the online portal. How do you determine how big of a sample size you need to have a high percentage of confidence in the result of your test? So again, this is tough, right? This gets down to statistical significance. It's like this combination between like the volume of people and the disparity between your test versions, like the disparity in the results of your test versions is kind of gonna give you that idea of statistical significance. There's no right answer, right? Like, the more users you can have coming through, the better. But if you have a smaller number, a couple hundred, a couple dozen, but the results are so diametrically opposed, then cool, that's all you need. That's exactly it. That's the biggest thing about the test is it needs to be replicable. If it's not replicable, then you don't have statistical significance, right? So you need to, that's a great point. Thank you very much. If in doubt, try and run the same test again and just validate that you're getting the exact same results. So I think that kind of tackles the first two. For early stage startups, is it really practical to A/B test all these little details when you don't really have that many initial users? No. No, it's not practical. No, and it does not make sense, right? You're looking for big step change improvements. You're not ticky-tacking your way, again, by changing like book now to buy now and you get a 2% uptick in conversion rate. That doesn't mean shit if you have 10 users on your site, right? Like, you need to know, like, is what I'm saying resonating with my potential audience? Am I communicating the value of my product effectively? Am I making it easy for these users to book? Are there are there blockage points in my funnels, right? These are the things that you want to be testing for up front. It's not the little incremental ticky-tack improvements, because it won't move the needle for you guys. And it won't necessarily apply down the road after you have that volume coming through. Can you give us more details on how you're conducting the tests on annual contracts versus monthly contracts? Again, it depends on the platform you're using. It depends on the service provider. Some are free. Some are super duper expensive. Totally depends. Any other questions? All right. Thank you, guys. I hope this was helpful.